You know, the message of the gospel is being corrupted every day by the use of terms or phrases that Christians use to invite the lost to be saved. These terms demand or imply that human works or human effort is a part of the plan of salvation. Biblical salvation is wholly of the Lord. It's, according to Ephesians 2:9, not of works, lest anyone should boast or brag. Ephesians 2:9. The unsaved listen carefully to every word that we say when we present the gospel. Therefore, we need to be careful of what we say, because what we say is what the lost will hear. You might say, well, I don't believe in salvation by works. But use of the some of the terminology that people find popular today add works to the plan of salvation. And I believe that you and I are going to be held accountable for what we say, because that is what the lost will hear. Of 22 terms that are popular today that add works to salvation, one of those is commit your life to Christ. You might hear that many times, but actually the phrase commit your life, that you will not find that in the Bible anywhere to be saved, that you commit your life to Christ. But what it really means is you're promising to live your life from now until you die for Christ, and then you'll be saved. And then, of course, that's works. And we're not saved by works. I know that when I was pondering over that many years ago as to what was wrong with that phrase, I discovered over in Matthew chapter 22 something very interesting. You know, those who generally present this phrase, commit your life to Christ, generally develop that a little bit further and say that you're to commit your total emotion and will and intellect to Christ. And that's a popular evangelism tool by certain evangelistic groups in this country. But I was reading in Matthew 22 in verse 36 where a lawyer comes and tempts Christ, saying, Master, what is the great commandment in the law? And Jesus said unto him, Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. And immediately, all of a sudden, I said, oh my goodness, look how clever the devil is. You see, love is a commitment. And notice it says here, with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. And that compares to the emotion, the will, and the intellect in this presentation that many groups use, where you're to commit your total emotion, will, and intellect to Christ. And I said, you know, in reality, the devil has used semantics to get us to say to keep the first commandment is the great commandment, the first commandment as a means of salvation. We know we're not saved by the commandments. Romans 3:28 says, therefore we conclude. That's the conclusion of the first three chapters of the book of Romans. And it says, we conclude that a man is justified by faith without the deeds of the law. So we're not saved by the deeds of the law. Galatians 2:16 says, knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but by faith in Jesus Christ. Even we have believed in Jesus Christ, that we might be justified by faith in Christ and not by the works of the law. For by the works of the law shall no flesh be justified. Yet the devil is clever enough to take a phrase, commit your life or commit your total emotion, will, and intellect to Christ. And people just miss the connection here because it's identical with saying you have to keep the first commandment. And we know that nobody's ever been saved by the commandments and nobody could ever do this. But this verse says thou shalt love or commit, basically. Love is a commitment to meet the needs of that person that is loved. And it says thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, comparable to the emotions, with all thy soul, the will, and with all thy intellect, which is all thy mind. And there you have it. The devil is a clever devil, isn't he? Nowhere does the Bible say you have to commit your life to Christ to be saved. The Bible says you trust Christ as the one who made the complete payment for your sins at the cross. And so to commit your life to Christ is a false gospel. Now, once a person becomes saved, then it's legitimate to ask a person to commit their life to Christ, because as a believer, we ought to live for Christ. We ought to commit our life to live for Him all the days of our life. But we don't live for Christ to be saved. We trust Christ in what He did for us. You see, it's not what we do for God that saves us. It's what God did for us in Christ at the cross that brings about our salvation. And it's so important to make that distinction. It's not what we do for Christ, but it's what Christ did for us that brings about salvation. When we trust in the finished work of Christ, we become saved. Another one is that you have to give your heart or give your life to Christ to be saved. And that's amazing because, again, that completely reverses the plan of salvation as it's given in the Bible. I've heard some good Bible teachers, when they get to the invitation, say it's not too late for you to get saved. It's not too late for you to give your heart or your life to Christ. Let me just talk about John 1:12, a wonderful salvation verse. And it says, to as many as received Jesus Christ, to them God gave the authority for them to become the sons of God, to them that believe on His name. This verse, and almost every verse you see, well, all the verses on salvation have this order, that God is the giver and that we're the receivers. John 1:12 says, to as many as received Jesus Christ, God gave authority for them to become the sons of God. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that He gave. God is the giver. We're the receivers as far as salvation is concerned. God has made the provision. We simply receive it. To tell somebody that's lost that they have to give their life to Christ or give their heart makes us the giver and God the receiver. Do you follow me? It's the exact opposite of what the Bible teaches. The Bible teaches in salvation, without exception, that God is the giver, that we're the receivers. But when you say that you have to give anything to God to be saved, that makes you the giver and God the receiver. That is 180 degrees out of phase with the plan of salvation as given in the Bible. God is the giver every place. The gift of God is eternal life, Romans 6:23 says. It's God's gift. God purchased salvation by Christ's death at the cross, and we simply receive it. But to say that we have to give our heart or our life to Christ to be saved doesn't make any sense. It's the exact opposite. And I always wonder, why do they say give your heart? Why don't they say give your liver, or your pancreas, or your thyroid, or maybe your adenoids? Why? I mean, you know, God doesn't want any of your body parts. He's not asking for you to give your toe, or your leg, or your arm to be saved. Jesus Christ gave His whole body. He gave His life at the cross. He's the one that's the giver. He gave His life. He gave His blood at the cross. It was shed there to pay for your sin and mine. And when you trust in what Jesus did for you and what He gave as He gave His life for you, God gives you eternal life. But to say that we have to give something to God is the exact opposite of what the Bible teaches. You know, it's amazing. And I have listed here, and I'm sure I could make the list grow because there are so many things that preachers, evangelists, and teachers and lay people are using and saying that are popular but are wrong because they add works to salvation. The simple message of the gospel is corrupted every day by use of terms and phrases that Christians use to invite the lost to be saved, and these terms often demand or imply human works or human effort is a part of the plan of salvation. But we find that biblical salvation is all of God, nothing of self. We simply receive the finished work of Christ, trusting that He made the full payment for our sins at the cross. And when we trust Him as the one who did that, God saves us. I hope you've done that. I hope you've trusted Christ as the one who died for you and received His gift of eternal life. There's nothing you can give God to be saved. He's the giver. We're the receivers.